In this presentation, we're going to look at the basic principles of our consumer's unit, or a distribution board, or maybe called a fuse box for those people in their early stages of study. So we're going to have a look at the basic principles of what the main switch is doing, the overcurrent protection, and the earth fault protection is doing within the distribution board itself. So we go to the mains end position in any domestic dwelling and we find the consumer's unit. In this case, this is a 17th edition Amendment 3 distribution board and is made completely of metal. It also has a lid that closes down, so it falls into a closed position. As we look at the outside of it, I believe at least one sticker is missing. We haven't got the one for the periodic inspection, so telling me the date of when it was inspected and the date of when it should be re-inspected. I'll find one of those in a moment. A domestic dwelling requires re-inspection no greater than 10 years between the inspections. We have got one sticker on the consumer unit front. This is the one telling the customer they need to test their RCD by pressing the test button, seeing it go from the on position to the off and reset it. That should be carried out quarterly or every 3 months, something that's often missed in domestic dwellings, that customers don't go to their consumer unit end and test quarterly their RCD. When we open up the flap, we can see some of our overcurrent protection devices, our RCCBs, and our main switch. So let's have a look at the functions of those then. So every distribution board or consumer's unit or fuse box, whatever we would like to call it, let's call it a distribution board, should have means of isolation. In this case, on the right-hand side for me, we've got the double pole or linked main switch. This can appear on the other side depending on the design of the consumer's unit. And this switch here can be used for two purposes. It can be used for mechanical maintenance, so we can isolate and work on the electrical system, or it can be used as an emergency isolation. For mechanical maintenance, I would expect us to turn off the overcurrent protection devices within the installation and then turn off offload the main switch. And we can see now it's gone to green at the top, green to suggest it is off. And when we're in the on position, that switch blades are red at the top, so for danger. So if we're going to use this for mechanical maintenance, I expect the distribution board to be isolated and the main switch to be turned offload. However, the same switch can be used for emergency isolation. So in other words, we can use it as a on-load isolating switch. So the installation is completely on and for some reason, the electrical current needs to be turned off in a rush. So you can turn it off on full load as an emergency isolating switch as well. This is double pole. It will turn off both live conductors, both live conductors being line and neutral, and it turns them off simultaneously. So together it will turn off both line and neutral. This is often called a double pole switch, but also in the regulations can be called a linked main switch. All distribution boards need to offer overcurrent and short circuit protection, and that's in the form of a fuse. In this case, that is being offered by a circuit breaker, and we've got circuit breakers throughout the distribution board here. So they're offering overcurrent. In other words, you have a healthy circuit, say in this one rated the first one of 20 amps. A healthy circuit rated at 20 amps is asked to draw, say, 30 amps over a period of time. Then we expect over a period of time that overcurrent protection device to operate. That will not operate necessarily within the maximum given time for an overload. In other words, circuits up to and including 32 amps must currently, under the 17th edition wiring regulations, disconnect within 0.4 of a second. But for an overload fault, this could be many minutes or many hours before operation occurs. This will be explained in the classroom when we look at fusing factors, the amount of current required to operate a device. So it might be rated the first device at 20 amps. It doesn't mean it will operate when it gets over 20 amps. So for overload, the disconnection time in this case of 0.4 is not applicable. The disconnection times are applicable when we look at short circuit. In other words, line and neutral have come together, or a live conductor and earth have come together, causing rapid disconnection of the supply. So we might have a fault of a negligible impedance in circuit, and we expect that huge fault current to be cleared very quickly. And as we just said, the first device being rated at 20 amps under those conditions would disconnect within 0.4 of a second or less. As we move down, we've got a 32, 6, a 32, and a 20. These are all type B circuit breakers. These are used in domestic dwelling where there are few surging loads. So we haven't got many loads that can draw massive inrush currents. When we move into industry and look in distribution boards, we often see C-type breakers within the distribution board, or D-type. So where we have huge inrush currents on things like welding equipment and some air conditioning units, you may have a D-type breaker. and where you have lots of fluorescent lighting circuits being switched on in one go, you tend to have C-type breakers. Again, we'll cover that in the classroom. So as well as having the linked main switch and overcurrent and short circuit protection offered by circuit breakers, this distribution board, as many do now in industry, have residual current devices in two positions here, protecting the outgoing final circuits. These RCDs are rated at 30 milliamps or less and offer additional protection. We will go through additional protection in the classroom, and we have done in some of my other video presentations. The RCD will clear earth faults. So a live conductor, either line or neutral, to earth faults will cause the RCD to operate. And if we press the test button, we can see that the RCD will trip into the off position and require, once the fault has been cleared, re-energizing, okay, pushing back to the on position. We can have circuits that aren't additionally protected, as we have here with a sub-main circuit. We'll go into that into the classroom, how we can get around some circuits not being additionally protected by an RCD. But generally, is in industry, you will have either RCBOs or RCCBs protecting the circuits within a domestic dwelling. So we've got several circuits this side of the RCD and several circuits this side of the RCD. The reason we split them across more than one, so we've got two in this case, RCCBs, is that we can have discrimination. So in other words, if one side was to trip off with an earth fault, we'll only lose 50% in this case of the installation. And best practice is to split lighting circuits and socket circuits oppositely over the actual two RCCBs. So in other words, if we had the downstairs sockets and upstairs lights this side, we'd have the downstairs lights and upstairs sockets this side. So in the event of losing one half of the installation, you still may have residual light offered by TVs and table lamps if you've lost the lights, as you're obviously therefore working your way down to the consumer's unit or to wherever it is positioned in order to reset the RCD. Often consumers can be fooled by the fact they believe their circuits are energized, but they have no power to things such as lights, TVs, and cookers, because when they get here, all their circuit breakers are in the up and on position. But what has potentially happened is that maybe one of the RCCBs has tripped out with an earth fault, and they've come along and looked to see that the breakers are all up, and they're now wondering why half their installation has no electricity. This is where an electrician can be called and comes out and simply clears the earth fault and resets the RCCB, and the circuit therefore re-energizes. So just be careful when you're out there in industry that we look not just at the circuit breakers to see if there's been a fault and one of those has potentially tripped off. It's easy to see that that circuit therefore is only off. Where more than one circuit has gone off, the chances are that one of your RCDs has operated, causing potentially half the installation to go off. Simply clear the earth fault, whatever's caused the issue, before resetting the RCD. Likewise, when we have a fault on a circuit breaker that's caused it to trip into the off position, we must clear the fault first before we re-energize the circuit breaker itself. If we don't clear the fault, it won't allow it to reset, it will keep tripping back out. All the overcurrent protection devices in this installation are B-type circuit breakers. Domestic dwellings have B-type circuit breakers where there is few surging currents in a domestic dwelling. However, as we move into industry, you may see C-types, perhaps where there's a lot of fluorescent lightings being turned on, and D-types where there's large compressor units, air conditioning units, or welding equipment where there's huge inrush currents when the item is turned on. Again, we'll cover that in another presentation on overcurrent protection devices and in the classroom, but these are all B type, so B20, B32, B6, B32, and a B20. Often we see the correct size fuse and sticker here suggesting what it is. So we've got a socket circuit here, picture, and we've got a B32, so we're thinking that's an A1 ring final circuit. Got a picture of a light here and a B6, and that suggests obviously it's a lighting circuit. Moving down here, we've got a picture of a cooker and a B32, so that makes sense as well. And then the final one is a socket, but this time it's a B20, perhaps suggesting that's an A3 radial circuit. Our sub-main garage feed is on a B20. So we've got B, C's and D type breakers. And we need to look in a domestic dwelling that they are all B types. We wouldn't want them all to be D or C types, and we will go into that into the classroom. So I'm going to have a look inside this distribution board, and we cannot take the cover off with it still in the on position. And as we said before, if this is for maintenance purposes, we should turn off the overcurrent protection devices, or we could have turned off the RCCBs. And then we're going to actually turn off the main switch. So we're now in the off position and we're going to undo these screws. Fortunately, in this installation, I've also got a linked main switch in the tail, so I could have isolated there. They're not as common as they should be. So for this installation and for this video, I've just turned off the main switch after turning off the overcurrent protection devices. And now I'm going to take the consumer unit front off. So we can see the consumer unit cover is now off. So our main switch is off, we've taken off the consumer unit cover and we're potentially looking to prove isolation before we work in here. So we're proving at the bottom of the main switch that the board is isolated before doing any work. And I'll show that in another presentation, how to secure isolation and prove the bottom of the main switch is isolated. I've done that off camera. And now we're looking at the basic layout within a consumer's unit, in this case, a split board. So we've got, in this case, three neutral bars. Okay, we've got one for the dedicated circuit that is not on the RCD, which is our sub-main circuit, going off to a garage in steel wire armored cable. We've got an earth metallic sheath and doesn't require RCD protecting. And then we've got the two RCDs neutral bars. So you've got to be careful to make sure you watch which neutral follows onto which bar when positioning the line conductors this side with the appropriate neutral from the RCD of which you've got the line from. So equally this side, the line bar here at the bottom, okay, is for this board, and then we come across to this RCD here. I don't like the fact that we've left these bare, and I've left them bare for this presentation to show you what happens in industry. We have no IP rating protection on these, well, we have everywhere else. I cannot touch any of the live parts here or here, but I can touch them on the top of that buzz bar, which is not good practice. They should be insulated with a little plastic seal over the top, which I showed in one of my previous presentations. I've shown it like this because this is often what we see in industry. Perhaps the bar should have been cut off altogether, so it's only being used for the circuit breakers, that side of the RCD and that side of the RCD, so we'd get rid of the problem that way. It's imperative that you get the appropriate neutral from RCDs and lines into the appropriate neutrals here. In the event of you having a neutral in the wrong side of the RCD, you create an out of balance, which will cause you, when you go to energize the circuit, for the RCD just to keep dropping out. We have only one earth bar, of which they all go into. So we've terminated not only the main earthing conductor, but also the circuit protective conductors into that earth bar. We can also see in this installation how we've identified L and N on the tails, as well as number identification on the conductors, such as your neutrals and CPCs. So in the event of me wanting to disconnect a circuit, if I was to pull out line conductor 3, I'm looking for neutral 3 and CPC 3 in order to remove that circuit from the distribution board and then take it out. Perhaps it's being replaced or removed. So to recap them, linked main switch double pole can be used for maintenance or emergency. We prefer to turn this switch off with no loading circuit. It turns off both line and neutral simultaneously or together. We can see those two conductors coming to the top of it. We cannot touch any of the live parts. Therefore, even inside the consumer unit, we've got IP2X. However, we fail here for IP2X on both sides because we haven't cut or insulated the rest of the buzz bar. We identify the conductors with tags such as L, N, and then number identification for each individual circuit. In the event of needing to remove a circuit, we should be able to see the number on the tag on the line conductor, same on the neutral and same on the circuit protective conductor in order to remove it. So that concludes some of the basic principles of what's happening within our distribution board, consumer's unit, or fuse box, whatever we're going to call it at this stage, looking at isolation, overcurrent protection, and earth fault protection. Remember, you can follow my group on Facebook if you want. If you look in the description of or any of my videos, you'll see a link to my Facebook page, and you can see what's going on within my classroom and some of the things I post on there to help them. Hope this video has been some help.